Good morning and welcome to worship. My call to worship comes from Psalm 40. I waited patiently for the Lord's help. Then he listened to me and heard my cry. He pulled me out of a dangerous pit, out of the deadly quicksand. He set me safely on a rock and made me secure. He taught me to sing a new song, a song of praise to our God. Happy are those who trust the Lord, who do not turn to idols or join those who worship false gods. Let's worship God in our opening hymn, Mission Praise 528, O Worship the King, O Glorious Above. Let us turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for this time to bring you our worship. Help us to use it. Help us through this time together to realize that you are here with us, to realize how many good things you have given us, and to understand how much you love us. Teach us to listen to your voice and to follow where you lead, to love one another and to live as your family, to be the people you would like us to be. Give us a sense of your presence in all things, the assurance that you forgive us, and strength to change our ways. Help us to know your will, courage to accept your guidance, and faith to bring your kingdom. Loving God, we thank you that we can put our hand into yours, knowing that you will lead, support, and hold us throughout our lives, that you will meet all our needs and far more besides. We thank you that you always hold firm to us in spite of our faults, never letting go of us, even when we let go of you. Forgive us that we have let go of you so often, determined to do our own thing. Forgive us for doubting you when times are hard, questioning your ability to lead us safely through. Forgive us for reaching out to you only when we need you, expecting you to get us out of trouble of our own making and to set us on our feet again. Help us to put our hand in yours in simple trust, quiet confidence, and eager expectation, knowing that whatever we face and wherever we are, you will hold us. And as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, we use his words, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Ooh, nice and loud. Okay. Who's got chocolate or eggs or any kind of form of chocolate left from Easter? That's everybody, boys and girls, mums and dads, grannies, I need to take my glasses off. Hands up again. I have to say there's more children than adults that have chocolate left. But that might mean they got more than you did. That's usually the case, isn't it? Yes. Well, do you know something? If everybody eats their chocolate, is that Easter finished? Is that Easter finished then? Oh, all the chocolate's gone. That means that all the celebrations are gone. And that's it. Okay, well, let's think. What happened at Easter? What happened at Easter? And then what? Yes, Jesus died on the cross, but more importantly, that was not the end. He rose again. But more importantly than that, that's not the end either. That's not pack it away in your head. Jesus has risen. Hallelujah. There's more to that. I've got a little kind of quiz, but just to see how we perceive things. Katie and Keris, could you come out for me, please? You don't have to say anything, don't worry. If one stands one side of the table, and one side channels, then that's it. Right. I want you to have impossible. I hold it at the two sides. This says impossible, and this says, and no challenging me on my spelling. I had to write one out twice. Yeah, two S's and whatever M's. Anyway, so there's some questions that happen in our lives. I just want to read a couple of questions out, and I want you to respond whether you think it's impossible or possible. So, okay, can a fish live out of water. Is that impossible or possible? If you think it's possible, put your hands up. Oh, right, okay. If you think it's impossible, put your hands up. Yeah, so hold that one up. I think it's impossible, right? Now, somebody will tell me otherwise, but anyway. Can a person get younger instead of older? Is that possible, do you think? Wishful thinking, but not possible. And is it impossible? Hold impossible up. Yep, it's held up. That's it. Can a person make £1 million starting from just £1? If you think it's possible, put your hand up. Yeah, it is possible. It seems extremely unlikely, but anyway. Can a person turn their head 360 degrees around? I know we have doctors in the thing that if you don't try this at home or here. Can anybody say that that is possible? Oh, your mum's a doctor as well. I don't know what your mum does, but I've never seen that happen. Right, hold it up again. It's impossible. Right. Can an athlete record a length of over 8 meters on the long jump? Now, 8 meters is quite a long way, isn't it? So anybody think it's possible over 8 meters on the long jump? Yep. Pete thinks it's possible. Right, okay. Yes, it is possible because the world record is 8.9 meters. So that's definitely a good one. Right. Can a person eat 5 cream crackers in 1 minute without a drink? No. The world record, believe it or not, without a drink to eat cream crackers is only 3 cream crackers. And actual fact, you can actually choke and die if you don't have a drink straight afterwards. So it's not possible, so impossible, right? Can a whale drown? Boys and girls, can a whale drown? Possible? Impossible. You think possible? Yes, because if water goes into a whale's blowhole at the top, it can drown. Just like we could drown on 1 teacup of water or fluid. So that is possible. Right. Can a dead person live again? Can a dead person live again? Hands up if you think it's possible. Yes, it's possible because Jesus was dead and he rose again. And God did the impossible and made it possible that his son, Jesus, rose from the dead because of what God did. So this is what we mean by Easter, you know? So those who believe that God was raised from the dead on Easter Day, put your hands up. If you believe that Jesus was risen from the dead on Christmas, on Easter, on Easter, beg your pardon. So God can make the impossible possible. So when we think about Easter, we know, thank you girls, would you like to put that down in a minute? I've got a short bit of scripture to read because after he rose from the dead, he was seen by many people following Easter Sunday. He was seen by quite a few. Now, if somebody was rose from the dead that had died here and we saw him, it would pass around, wouldn't it? people would be texting. Hey, you know, remember that guy that died last week? I saw him. I saw him today in B&M's. Well, really, in those days, we didn't have B&M's to start with, but anyway, it was the disciples that Jesus appeared to. But they were really, really stunned. They didn't recognize him at first. When they were walking along the road with him, he appeared. And Jesus said, well, he said the whole group that he saw were terribly frightened, thinking they had seen a ghost. Now, sometimes we can ghost Jesus. We don't believe what he's done. We don't believe that he can do miracles. We don't believe that he lives in our hearts and makes us better people. So, why are you frightened? He said to the disciples. Why do you doubt who I am? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. You can see that it's really me. Touch me and make sure I am not a ghost. Because ghosts don't have bodies, as you see that I do. So Jesus was standing in front of them. And as he spoke, he held out his hands for them to see and showed them his feet. They still stood there doubting, filled with joy and wonder. Then he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" And he ate fish. Well, if he was a ghost, or they don't eat anything. They don't need to. They haven't got bodies. So, when I was with you before, Jesus said, and told you everything that I had written about me, and Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must all come true. Yes, it was written long ago that the Messiah must suffer and die and rise again from the dead on the third day. So what he's saying, what Jesus is saying, this happened in the Old Testament. They were told about this through prophecy. Everything happened in the Old Testament, and it was all coming true. So Jesus did indeed rise from the dead. He did indeed go up to heaven, and he does indeed live in our hearts. So don't stop thinking about Jesus or saying, "Hallelujah, he's risen," just on Easter day. Think about it for the rest of our lives. He is here with us. He lives in our hearts. He can do things in our lives that we wouldn't even, we would think were impossible. And he makes them possible because he loves us. Think about that this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Marianne. Let's sing our next hymn, Liberty's Praise 71, Jesus Loves Me.
Little ones to raise.
Young church, time for you to leave and go through for your activities. Bye.
I wonder how many of you have known that song all your lives, like me. I remember vividly when the church where we were before, she was elderly by this time, who had led the young Sunday school for years and years as well. And I remember her saying that was her favourite hymn. And because it just says it like it is, eh? The Bible tells me so, Jesus loves me. The facts. Our notices for this week, we've got a whole week full of activities, isn't it good? We've got to the end of the school holidays, so things are happening once again. The Monday Ladies Fellowship group resumes on Monday, tomorrow, in Kinnaird. If you're interested, speak to Selma, and you're not already in it. Larbert East Women's Group AGM is on Tuesday at the Trice Golf Club, and then there's going to be high tea. I think everybody who's, it will be for everybody who's signed up to go. Wednesday, we have our Kirk Session meeting at 7 o'clock, and in the notices it says two elders are asked to save the date of 11th May for an elders' conference at Westfield Stadium. That will be in the morning. And that has now been confirmed for elders. And I'll say a bit more about that later on. Weekday worship on Thursday at 11:15 a.m. It will be led by Gregor Mackay from Larbert Church's Youth Trust. And there's tea and coffee available before the service. And then on Thursday, there's a concert at Airth Parish Church. Matthew and Philip Todd, who are two of the family of Jim Todd, and I think professional singers, they will be singing. I think those of you who went along last year, about just over a year ago, to Jim's birthday concert, I believe it went very well, and it was much appreciated. Rachel Zylstra, Walkinshaw, well, Dave and I have heard Rachel singing as well at a house concert a few years ago and really enjoyed it. So that's 7 o'clock on Friday of this week, and then on the 10th of May as well. And on Saturday evening, the Social Committee at Larbert Old Parish Church has organised an evening with Tenement Jazz Band at 7:30 p.m. That's £10 for a ticket, and bring your own snacks, drinks and glasses. And the details are there to contact Margaret Hall if you are interested in getting tickets for that. I've been asked to mention as well, it seems terribly dull to go down to bins, but Craigan has spoken to me about cross-contamination in the bins that we leave to be uplifted. You know how we separate our rubbish into the recycling bins at home. We have to do that here as well. And the council will not empty our bins if there is mixed stuff in it. So make sure, if you're putting stuff in the bins here, that you separate out the paper, card, tins, bottles, and so on, as you would do at home. Most of us, of course, aren't perhaps involved in that, but it's something that we have to be well aware of. Otherwise, say the council they won't empty our bins. Now, I have an update from Wallace's group to read to you, but before I do that, just to kind of mention generally the details around the Presbytery Plan, which To be honest, we have been talking about it for a long time, and in fact, 6 months ago, we should have had this sorted, but Anne is going to read an edict from the presbytery to invite us to a meeting, and we'll do that just in a little while. Before that, a reminder that our bit of the presbytery plan involves ourselves, Larbert West, Stenhouse and Carron, and Airth churches. And if you wonder where Wallace's came from, if you take all the initial letters from the different churches, we thought that's quite a handy way of talking about the group that is making the plans. It's not the new name of the church. We're still looking for that. We're still looking for suggestions. I've had a few from people here, but the deadline is approaching for that, and I'll mention that just in a minute. But this is really getting, as it were, getting serious, and we have put together a plan for what we want the church to be like. It's kind of vague at the moment, but it will, I hope, take shape as we talk and get closer to the time when we're actually going to join together. I think by the end of this year, well, actually, after the end of this month, we should be a bit further forward, because Presbytery meets on the 27th of April, and a decision will be taken then on the whole Presbytery plan, not just one group of churches in Larbert, but all the churches from pretty much from here. I think Airth, or perhaps one in Bowness, is about the furthest away, all the way down to South Lanarkshire. That decision covers everybody, and everybody's kind of got to come in or come to an agreement. However, our four churches have been talking together for some time, and as I say, we're now the Wallace's group, which, you know, if you think of Wallace, think that means Larbert West, Larbert East, Stenhouse and Carron, and Airth. And they're all in there. We had a meeting on Monday, and as I said before, every time we have a meeting, which is every month, I will have an update to read to you, to sum up what has been decided. And there's a lot more notes behind that, but it means that everybody in all the churches hears this at the same time. So this update says that we listened to a very informative and challenging presentation about what's involved in preparing a basis of union. We're not there yet, but we will get to that stage. And this is the stage at which we can go on to start looking for a minister for our new church. We've arranged a joint Kirk Session Visioning and Planning Day to be held on the 11th of May. And that's for all the elders of all the churches to come along to. Thanks to everyone for their suggestions of the new church at Larbert name. There is still opportunity if you have any ideas. The last date for submissions is Sunday, the 5th of May. We have collected information about each manse and hall use. These will be collated. In other words, all the groups that use our premises, we've just kind of put a timetable together with everything on it, and the other churches are doing the same, and we've got to see where we can fit in the various groups that want to meet together, and plan for what we want to do in the future as well in terms of groups. So, I mean, I'm departing from my official script, but if you have ideas for things that, as a joint church, we can do that we can't do now, let me know. We're currently planning joint services. The minister and local ministers, the minister being Jim Todd, and the local ministers will organise this, and this may well be over the summer months. We're working on weeding out items no longer needed before we complete inventories. Inventories should be completed by the end of June. And the next meeting will take place on Monday the 8th of May. No, it's not Monday the 8th of May. It's Monday the 13th of May. In Stenhouse and Carron Church. We have been now in three of the four churches, and the next meeting will be in Stenhouse and Carron Church. That's on the 13th of May, because the first Monday is holiday weekend, and it will be in Stenhouse and Carron. And now I'll ask Anne to read out officially the edict, which tells us what our instructions are next.
I'll be reading this out on two Sundays. The citation is to be read on two Sundays before the presbytery meeting. The congregation of Larbert East is hereby cited to attend for their interests at the meeting of the presbytery called for the specific purpose of receiving and approving the draft presbytery mission plan on Saturday, the 27th of April 2024, at 9:30 a.m. at DL St Andrew's Parish Church, The Cross, 43 to 47 Mary Street, Motherwell, and online. At this meeting of presbytery, the presbytery will take up consideration of the report of the Mission Plan Action Group, including the draft presbytery mission plan. The congregation is cited to attend for their interest by sending a maximum of three individuals, in addition to those who are members of presbytery and entitled to respond to the report through the contribution of one person representing the congregation. And that's signed by Brian Kerr, the deputy clerk.
Thanks, Anne. I thought I'd better just say that it's not for everybody to turn up at DL St Andrew's Church, but then of course it went on to say three representatives from our congregation, and the elders will be selecting the people at the meeting this week. George Peden is our presbytery elder, so he will be there anyway, and three other people will be going along.
Our first reading this morning comes from 1 John chapter 3, starting at verse 1. See how much the Father has loved us. His love is so great that we are called God's children, and so in fact we are. This is why the world does not know us. It has not known God. My dear friends, we are now God's children, but it is not yet clear what we shall become. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he really is. Everyone who has this hope in Christ keeps himself pure, just as Christ is pure. Whoever sins is guilty of breaking God's law, because sin is a breaking of the law. You know that Christ appeared in order to take away sins, and that there is no sin in him. So everyone who lives in union with Christ does not continue to sin, but whoever continues to sin has never seen him or known him. Let no one deceive you, my children. Whoever does what is right is righteous, just as Christ is righteous. And our second reading comes from Luke chapter 24, starting at verse 36. While the two were telling them this, suddenly the Lord himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were terrified, thinking that they were seeing a ghost. But he said to them, "Why are you alarmed? Why are these doubts coming up in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet and see that it is I myself. Feel me and you will know, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bones, as you can see I have." He said this and showed them his hands and his feet. They still could not believe. They were so full of joy and wonder. So he asked them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of cooked fish, which he took and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are the very things I told you about while I was still with you. Everything written about me in the law of Moses, the writings of the prophets, and the Psalms had to come true." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "This is what is written. The Messiah must suffer and must rise from death 3 days later. And in his name, the message about repentance and the forgiveness of sins must be preached to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses to all of these things.
Mission Praise 506, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder.
Consider all the works I have done.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. See how much the Father has loved us. His love is so great that we are called God's children, and so, in fact, we are. So writes John in the first of his three letters. Unlike Jesus, none of us is the physical product of God and a human mother. We are all born of two human parents. But God has adopted us, his children. And that notion of adoption is one close to my heart as I spent a good proportion of my working life recruiting, preparing, and supporting temporary and permanent families for children who couldn't remain with their birth families for one reason or another. John points out that whilst we are God's children, it is not yet clear what we shall become. Just as it's impossible to know how a newborn baby will turn out in the end, it is impossible to know how any of us, Christian or otherwise, might turn out. As social workers, we were tasked to assist struggling parents to find more appropriate ways of living, and especially of parenting. But what we also knew, what we believed, was that if families couldn't or wouldn't change, leaving children in harmful family situations was unlikely to have a satisfactory outcome for them or indeed for others around them. So it was important that families rising to the challenge of offering a home to children who had not had the best start in life understood the often enormous task they were undertaking. They had to be prepared to meet challenges that they had never experienced in their own lives or with their own children. And at one time, we assumed that sufficient TLC was all that was needed. But in time, it became clear that whilst lots of tender, loving care would indeed be required, sadly for many children, that wasn't enough. By the time many of these children were received into the care of the local authority, they were physically and emotionally damaged. They hadn't experienced the stability of loving families, often because neither had their own parents, who therefore had little real understanding of the needs of their children. Yet for children to be removed from their homes, even less than suitable ones, is traumatic. Inevitably, all children become attached to those they live with. It is, after all, a survival mechanism. So when children are placed in a different family, that's confusing and frightening. Thus, there's a major task for the receiving family receiving a child placed with strangers. Barriers of fear and suspicion need to be broken down. And that takes time and a lot of patience. Children have to be assumed that whatever has happened to them is not their fault. And they need help to understand why their own families are unable to meet their needs. In undertaking such a task, foster and adoptive families, including their own children, often have to bear a lot of challenging behaviours before the children placed with them are able to set down and learn a different way of living. And in carrying out these tasks, these foster and adoptive families need support. Support to keep going, support to deal with the anger, skepticism, and rebellion of children placed in their care. And support to keep hope and indeed faith alive. And it seems to me that there's a parallel here in terms of the tasks of substitute families with what John is suggesting in his first letter. Just as there's no way for substitute families, or any other families for that matter, to know how their children will turn out. There is no way to be sure that, even given the appropriate teaching about Jesus and about God, any particular person will accept the truth of the gospel. But like substitute families who work tirelessly towards bringing up children to the point where they can accept as good a different way of being, we as a Christian family need to also work tirelessly to share our faith, to share how our faith gives us strength, hope, and a clear pattern for living. John talks about the need to keep Christ at the center of our vision. He suggests that if we remain faithful, when Christ returns, we shall be like him. But he adds a warning when he says, everyone who lives in union with Christ does not continue to sin, but whoever continues to sin has never seen him or known him. Now, we're all at times guilty of straying. We're all subject to the pressures of society, of our world, of innumerable temptations. And which of us can genuinely claim not to have ever yielded to temptation, even in some small thing? But what is important is that we recognize our flaws, own up to them, and avoid repetition. More importantly, though, is to hold on to faith. Faith that in time we shall see Jesus. And then the passage from Luke's Gospel tells us of an event following on from Jesus revealing himself to people walking along the road to Emmaus. In this passage, John once again appears to his disciples. Now, whilst two of them who had witnessed Jesus on that occasion at Emmaus were telling others the story, Jesus suddenly appeared. Yet despite Jesus assuring them before his crucifixion that he would be raised from the dead, and despite the testimony of these two witnesses, the disciples thought they were seeing a ghost. As he had done with Thomas, Jesus urged them to touch him, to reassure themselves that he was indeed alive. Yet still they doubted. And so Jesus asked for something to eat, and they gave him a piece of cooked fish, which he ate in their presence. Proof positive that he wasn't a ghost. Ghosts, after all, aren't made of flesh and blood and bone. But then Jesus did something extraordinary. He opened their eyes to understand the scriptures and said to them, "This is what is written. The Messiah must suffer and must rise from death 3 days later. And in his name, the message about repentance and forgiveness of sins must be preached to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." What now? In his name, the message about repentance and forgiveness of sins must be preached to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. But what does that mean for us sitting here this morning or watching online? Well, it means that we too need to share Jesus' message. I know it's often difficult to tell people what we believe, why we come to church, or perhaps there are even times when we, like the disciples we heard about earlier, have moments of doubt about the reality of the gospel, the good news of Jesus. At least those disciples and many others actually did meet the risen Christ face to face. Few of us, if any, have had that privilege. We just have to take it on faith accepting that a 2,000-year-old story that people are still talking about today can't be just fiction. Surely it must be true. I've often heard churchgoers say things like, people aren't interested in the church nowadays. And no doubt that's very true. But it isn't the church we're called upon to worship. We're called to worship God and his Son, Jesus. So trying to share our faith with others needn't be about getting them through the door of the church, at least not initially. Initially, it's more about reflecting on our own faith, asking ourselves why we believe what we do. What is it that faith gives us? What prayers has God answered for us? And perhaps it's also about pondering what our lives would be like if we didn't have faith. Then would be the time to share that with others who do not yet have faith. And what's the worst that can happen? After all, we live in a country where there's freedom of belief and religion. We're not going to be persecuted for our faith. We're free to worship openly. We don't need to worship in secret for fear of punishment, as happens in some countries. Now, the success of adoptive and foster families that I spoke about earlier starts with a huge leap of faith. A different kind of faith, admittedly. They have faith in their own understanding of what children need as they grow up. Sometimes learned from negative experiences of their own. And perhaps it takes that kind of negative experience for someone to want to help another person. They have faith in their confidence that they can change lives for the better. But they also understand that this won't happen overnight. Rome was not built in a day, after all. Their success begins from a place of love, a place of unconditional love, such as Jesus himself offered. And it also springs from an acceptance that their love may at times be rejected over and over and over again until the child or children they're caring for are able to accept love, particularly if it's a new experience for them. Substitute families have to accept that they're in it for the long haul. So they need to be tenacious. They need to never give up. In a sense, they need confidence in themselves that what they are doing is worthwhile. And in a sense, these are the qualities we need when faced with the skepticism of non-believers. We need to be secure in our own faith, tenacious in sharing it, willing to face rejection after rejection, but still keep going. And above all, we need to show the love of Jesus in what we do. In his name, the message is about a message about repentance and forgiveness of sins must be preached to all nations, beginning not in Jerusalem, but in Larbert. You are witnesses of these things. Amen. Let us sing together our next hymn, Mission Praise 496, Oh for a Thousand Tongues.
Thank you.
Loving God, so often we fail to thank you for all we have received. We are quick to ask for more, but slow to appreciate what we have already received. We are quick to bring our requests, but slow to show gratitude when we are granted. We are quick to complain when life is hard, but slow to rejoice when it is good. Loving God, forgive us and receive now these gifts, offered to you as our way of saying what we should have said so many times before. Thank you for everything. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning to ask for your help, support, and love for others. We pray for the many people all around the world who live with wars, uprisings, floods, and droughts, affecting the most vulnerable, leaving them homeless, starving, and frightened. Father, surround these desperate people with your love and give them hope. We also pray for our leaders and those in positions of authority worldwide, asking you to grant them wisdom, courage, and basic common sense as they make decisions affecting the lives of others. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that we're able to worship you freely without fear of any kind. We thank you too for the many young people in our midst, from the gurgling babies in their mother's arms to the teenagers worrying about their approaching exams. They are our future church. We thank you for all those who support our young people, helping them in the creche, young church, and with the resumption of lunch in the East. Surround them with your love. In the next few weeks and months, our session will have to make many difficult decisions about the church's future. Father, guide them and support them in their thinking and surround them with your love. We all know of someone this morning who needs your love and our prayers. In a time of silence, we bring them to you. Comfort those who are suffering in body, mind, and spirit. Give them hope and courage in their troubles and surround them with your love. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to love one another and pray for those in need. Amen.
Thank you, Sheila. We sing our last hymn, and we'll sing it twice because it's a short one. You shall go out with joy. Turn now to the world, for Christ is there waiting to meet you and greet you. Go back with eyes open to see him, ears open to hear him, a mind open to receive him, and a heart open to serve him. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and upon all those whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen.